This is the Energy Makers Show, featuring the innovators, financiers, and policymakers focused on the global energy demand. Brought to you by NRG, moving clean energy forward. And here's your host, Paul Dickerson.
Hi, I'm Paul Dickerson, and welcome to another episode of the Energy Makers Show. Today, Robin Knoke sits down with Ian Hatton, petroleum geologist with years of experience in the North Sea, and today, founder of Barry Onyx Offshore Wind, talking about his plans to build a large-scale offshore wind farm over a natural gas reservoir all in the Gulf of Mexico. All that right after this.
Where will the energy come from to move us forward? From natural sources in abundant supply, or perhaps a man-made source? At NRG, we believe innovation will solve our energy needs. That's why NRG is moving away from fossil fuels towards wind, solar, and other sustainable technologies to power the smart grid, the electric car, and our clean energy future. We're using all of our energy to develop more of it.
This is the Energy Maker Show, brought to you by NRG, moving clean energy forward. And now back to the Energy Maker Show.
Welcome back to the Energy Maker Show. I'm Robin Knoke, and my guest today is Ian Hatton, the CEO and founder of Barry Onyx Offshore Wind, right here in Texas, our very own offshore wind company. Welcome, Ian.
Well, thanks, Robin. Good to be here.
So I need you to go into your history, because it's really pertinent to how you got to where you are today in your career path.
Well, I'm a petroleum geologist by training. So I spent 20 odd years exploring for and drilling for oil and gas in the UK North Sea, working for firstly Phillips Petroleum and then for Kerr McGee. And then at the end of that period in time, when I enjoyed some success in discovery of a couple of very significant oil fields, decided to go out on my own and having an interest in things perhaps a little bit outside the box, looked at the potential to develop offshore wind in combination with offshore gas. So to convert the gas to electricity offshore and to export all the energy via a cable to the beach rather than the pipeline. So that's where the genesis of my company, Eclipse Energy, which we founded in 1999, that's what that was about. So that's where I got into offshore wind.
Ian, explain to me, if you're using natural gas to firm up offshore wind, how does that actually work?
The original project, which we called Ormond, which is located in the East Irish Sea in the UK, we actually picked the location because it sat over two small gas fields, which had never been developed by conventional means because they were effectively uneconomic or so-called stranded resources. Mm-hmm. So the idea was that we would put in a substation which would serve both the offshore wind farm and a mobile gas turbine platform. So it's, again, existing technology for a small platform with suction bucket foundations, which you could drill a well, tie to three aeroderivative gas turbines on board the vessel, and just burn the gas to complement the production from wind. Use the same cable to export energy to shore.
Interesting.
The simple, case being, as we know with wind farms, the load factors are mid-30s to high 40s percentage. And that translates into the cable. You've got to size your cable for the maximum production.
Mm-hmm.
But what that means is there's a large volume of it's basically time and volume of power transportation capacity on the cable, which is unused. And so it's effectively you're providing a means of monetizing the gas using the infrastructure of the wind farm. And then you have the opportunity to blend the two in order to provide a firmed supply of gas, of power, sorry, to the marketplace.
So when did you sell Eclipse, and then how did you get to Texas?
We eventually sold Eclipse in 2008 to the Swedish state energy company Vattenfall, and then at that time was contemplating, well, where's the next thing that we can do? And having spent most of my working life with US oil and gas companies, very content with the working arrangements in the States, relationships with people, so we took a look at where offshore wind could be developed. So we looked at California, the Gulf of Mexico, and the East Coast. And for a variety of reasons, we chose to proceed with Texas.
Some of those reasons being?
Well, it's firstly, it's a great wind resource. So it was the sort of wind speeds we were seeing were similar to those at the UK project we built, which was the Ormond Offshore Wind Farm, which was, again, revolutionary in terms of the wind farm component was these large 5 megawatt machines on four-legged jacket structures. So we felt that with that background that Texas was a good place to go because you've got the fabrication industries here as well as the wind resource. And also the state.
So we're using existing infrastructure and resources.
Existing engineering companies.
Engineering, okay.
Yeah. So the other facet of coming to Texas was that thanks to the early history of the state, you control the first three marine leagues of the so-called submerged lands. So,
and that's 10 miles?
Yeah, 10 statute miles, just over 10 statute miles.
We'll be back with more with Ian Hatton after this.
At BKD, we understand the constantly shifting nature of the energy industry. As a national CPA and advisory firm, we serve energy clients from the beginning to the end of the cycle. Our experienced energy advisors serve approximately 300 energy companies in exploration, midstream, downstream, oilfield services, and power production. Plus, we're the largest North American member of the Praxity Global Alliance, which means we can help you wherever you operate. Contact a BKD advisor or visit us online to learn more.
This is the Energy Maker Show, brought to you by NRG, moving clean energy forward. And now, back to the Energy Maker Show.
Welcome back to the Energy Maker Show, continuing on with Ian Hatton, CEO of Baryonics Corporation. Okay, maybe this is a dumb question, Ian, but what about hurricanes?
Yeah, well, obviously, that's going to be a point of the engineering work that goes into the project. But in essence, the turbines that we're employing are probably good for a Cat 3, at least. Part of the project is to undertake research, which is
meaning that you would leave them out there.
Oh yeah, they're permanent installations. Yeah, they've got to be able to stand up to whatever Mother Nature throws at them.
Okay.
But part of the research work is about modeling the stresses on the turbines in extreme wind conditions. There is a significant market in the world for turbines and rotors which can withstand very strong windstorm conditions. And within the project, within Go Wind itself, there is a research program which is being headed by Texas A&M and will incorporate the research departments of UT, Texas Tech, and in order to address some of these particular issues. And Siemens themselves are contributing to that program as they have a commercial interest in getting a solution for that kind of environment.
Now let's talk about your relationship with the Department of Energy and what's happening there, so that you bring us up to speed.
Well, last year, the Department of Energy offered an invitation for people to apply for a grant to develop a series of offshore wind demonstrators around the US with the intention of showing how the technology can be applied to lower the cost of energy and to be reliable, particularly for US offshore operations.
Mm-hmm.
One of the issues being that the continental shelf does drop off in water depth. It becomes quite deep quite quickly. And indeed, one of the first reasons that we chose to come to Texas when we compared the Gulf of Mexico versus, say, the West Coast. There are actually few places on the West Coast where you could develop a conventional offshore wind farm along the lines of those being developed in Europe. So back in June of 2012, we were invited to go interview with the Department of Energy in Washington for one of these grants for the offshore demonstrator, which we call Go Wind, Gulf Offshore Wind. And we've partnered with Siemens for that. So we're intending to deploy three of their latest 6 megawatt permanent magnet direct drive turbines. So these are
massive.
These are huge machines. I mean, if you know,
can you give us a size, just to something relative?
Well, if you know Austin, these turbines would stand about 80% of the height of the Frost Tower. So these are pretty big machines, and the rotors themselves would cover 2 football pitches. But that's and that's American football pitches, not UK soccer pitches. And what we're hoping to show is how the projects themselves can actually have an impact socially on South Texas, because this is a new large industry. So it provides jobs in mm-hmm. fabrication, mm-hmm. as well as providing energy to an area which currently suffers from a lack of power generation locally, which is causing some holdback in further economic development, because there's simply not enough indigenous power production
really
available. Yeah, we've been made aware of business opportunities that have been lost to South Texas because there's not been enough power gen available to them. Yeah.
So something else that y'all have looked at doing is pairing offshore wind with water and mm-hmm. the desalinization of water here in Texas to address another issue.
Yep.
Can you shine some light on that for us?
Sure. The desalination concept really came about a couple of years ago in recognizing, firstly, that there was an issue with Texas water supply. But then some of the work we did following from that, we became aware of technology that had been developed, particularly in the US, with regard to energy recovery devices, which are employed in other places around the world, but not in the US. And so when we started to build an economic model of coupling offshore wind to a desalination plant, I'm sure, it becomes quite an attractive economic proposition mm-hmm. based upon the fact that we'd be selling water, not power. And looking at the kind of level of water prices that there are in Texas right now, this thing would make some significant commercial sense. So we're working with that. We're teaming up with a company called Aquifer Group, which are based in Fredericksburg, Texas. And I think you're going to hear a little bit more about that company over the coming months in terms of their plans for working on the issue of water supply in Texas. So we're very pleased to be a part of that, and we think we've got something which is actually worth pursuing in economic terms. Is not only does it solve the water issue, but it also provides you with a plant which can be flipped out of water production and effectively peak shave on the electricity market. Mm-hmm. So it's actually extremely flexible, and it's all technically achievable with things which are in the marketplace now, today, and financeable. So we think it's a pretty hot to trot concept.
Well, that's really exciting to be solving Texas resource issues with Texas resources.
Yes, indeed. Indeed, yeah.
Ian, thank you so much for coming in today and sharing your story with us.
You're welcome. Thank you.
And that wraps up this episode of The Energy Makers Show, heard on the radio and seen online at theenergymakers.com.